This would be, I believe, the start of our long-awaited chapter 4. Not gonna lie, I'm a tad nervous, because right now I'm gonna be talking about the most critical, most important things you need to know about weapons in Half-Life. Understanding how they work is crucial in not only making new ones, but also modifying the existing ones. Just to note, in this video we'll only cover how to modify existing weapons. Why? Well, adding new weapons is very, very complicated, and that deserves an entire video of its own. So first of all, you need to know where everything is, and here's the answer. Let's start in weapons.h. This is where all the weapon classes are, and yes, this is where you can add your own ones. But more on that in the next video. Default ammo values are also in here. You'll notice that all weapons inherit from CBasePlayer weapon, so let's take a look at that class. Apart from the silly incomplete comment, we actually see some familiar looking stuff. We see save and restore, which clearly means this is a map entity, right? It's true, if you peek far enough, you'll see it ultimately inherits from CBase entity, so weapons are indeed entities just like any other. In actual games, this isn't quite the practice. Weapon pickups and weapons themselves are typically separate components. Anyway, there are some functions we can override. These are self-explanatory, I think, and they're called every frame if a certain button is pressed. Primary attack, for instance, is called every single frame if you're holding down the left mouse button. So, I guess you may need some sort of timer, you know, to control the rate of fire or maybe even introduce a semi-auto firing mode. Thankfully, such timers are already part of this class. The player contains an array of these weapons. It is practically the player's inventory. Every frame, that is, in the player's post-think method, weapon code is executed in case the player's holding a weapon. Item post-frame then updates the weapon's timers, performs some basic ammo logic, and other things. Here you can see exactly how primary attack's called. If the player's holding down the left mouse button and is able to attack, and it's time to attack, yeah, call primary attack on this very frame. Okay, so we know that, but the question is, what does actually happen inside primary attack though? Well, it depends on the weapon, because primary attack is a virtual function that's overridden by each subclass. Let's look at the crowbar and the Glock for instance. The crowbar swing method essentially does a trace line, but a tad different. Your natural first reaction is a big WTF, like what the hell is this? Also, what's the client DLL macro thing doing here? Like, what are these events? My gosh, so much stuff. But don't worry, we'll go through it all. Regarding the client DLL macro, you gotta understand that weapons are not only present on the server, but they're also on the client. Weapons are shared entities, but here's the thing, the client side doesn't have most things the server side has. It only has barely enough code to support CBasePlayer weapon, and none of the other base nor entity classes for the purposes of client-side prediction. It's complicated, it's Valve's mess. I'll talk about it more in the client-side programming chapter. What I want you to know for now is just that if you have to do anything regarding entities like damaging an entity or some other change that should be visible to all players on the server, you gotta wrap it around in this if and def. So that's something to keep in mind. As I said, I'll talk more about it in the client-side programming chapter, which is two chapters from here, but we'll get there eventually. Don't worry. Lastly, the event playbacks. If you recall anything from the last video when I was talking about messages, you know, the message begins stuff and stuff like that, this is basically just that. Gold Source has a user messages system, which is what you've used so far, but it also has an event system, which is basically a specialization of that. And it's used for weapon events most of the time, but you can use it for some other things as well. Either way, it just sends some data to the client to play back a given event for the purpose of particle effects, sound effects, and other stuff that the server should not care about. Okay, so let's do a few simple exercises, I guess. Here's what I'm gonna do for now. We're gonna make the crowbar explode when something is hit, and we're gonna make the pistol truly semi-automatic, and we're gonna make the MP5's magazine capacity to be 30 bullets instead of 50. In order to know where to write the explosion code, we need to find a piece of code that damages an entity, because at that point we certainly know that there was a hit. You don't want to explode if you just swing mid-air. You don't want that. The crowbar performs a trace hole, which is like a trace line except the trace is a box, not a line. We can obtain the position where the hit occurred. So that's easy. Just, you know, include the necessary header and call explosion create like we did before. Since this is a thing only the server can know and do, make sure it's... Oh, there's already an if and def in there. Good. Good.
Hello there.
Moving on to the next one. Making the pistol semi-auto requires some studying of the pistol code. Both primary attack and secondary attack call Glock fire, but with different parameters. The first parameter is the spread, second is the delay between shots. This is really interesting, isn't it? The Glock is actually an automatic weapon as far as the game is concerned. This is very, very bad for what we want in this example. We can actually make this semi-auto with a very simple trick. First, let's remove all of the stuff in secondary attack, because it will be made obsolete by this change. Second, go to Glockfire and write this very code. The code basically says, if the player held down left mouse button last frame, don't execute the attack. It kinda makes sense, I guess. If you're holding it down all the time, primary attack gets executed indeed all the time, at least regularly. You want it to attack only when the left mouse button click is fresh, so to speak. It'll become non-fresh the very next frame if you hold it down, but if you release it, it can become fresh again, if you know what I'm saying. Alright, so let's compile this code and try it out. Alright, so let's hold down the left mouse button just to actually verify that it's not gonna fire again, and... Wait, what? It's broken? Why is that? Well, actually, this is because I compiled just a server DLL. Remember what I said about weapons being shared entities? Yeah. For those, you need to compile both DLLs. Always, and I mean always, remember to do that, because this is a common mistake. You're basically having one code on the client and a completely different code on the server. I mean, it happens anyway, but like this is the stuff that shouldn't be different, you know? So just keep that in mind. Finally, if you want to change the stats of a weapon, there's generally two places to look. If you want to change damage values, look into skill.cfg. It contains most of the damage multipliers and all damage values that aren't controlled by mappers. If you want to change the fire rate or magazine capacity, you gotta do that either in the weapon's own .cpp file or in the weapons header. Fire rate, in the case of the Glock, is governed by whatever value you pass the Glock fire. For the MP5 and most other weapons, it's directly set via MFL next primary attack. Changing the values there will change the fire rate of it. Now let's change the magazine size, you know, go to weapons.ah down to MP5 max clip and change it to 30. They wrongly call them clips, but they're actually magazines. But thankfully we can use Visual Studio to rename all of these to something like mag or whatever. I won't do that here, just to remain consistent with literally every other SDK and tutorial series out there, but just know that you have the power to deviate from the norm. Just don't use it wrongly. Don't forget to compile both DLLs, of course, you remember what happened earlier. And that's the end for now. I wanted to make this a little bit more in-depth originally, but we will have many, many, many more examples and exercises in upcoming videos. You know, weapons don't have to be just weapons. You can have tools like weapons, but they interact with special entities in some unique way, like a wrench repairing a turret or whatever. Or, you know, key cards, like a literal key card weapon. You can show it to a certain NPC or a scanner and they let you through. Like, you just click while aiming at it and, you know, you can kind of imagine it, I guess. Just think of all the possibilities. There are no limits. In the next video, we'll see how to create completely new weapon classes, which is a slightly complex procedure, and how to implement a system which automates said procedure. Instead of writing 5 different, you know, CPP files, you just write one line of code, and you'll see what I mean. But until then, happy programming!